Hey, Budget Nerd here. Since I'm stuck in my home these days, I figured it was a good time to talk about network storage, which has been requested a few times. We'll go over why you might want network storage, what options there are, pros and cons of each, and how to do it, as you may have guessed, on a budget. At a very basic level, network storage is a central location accessible to any device on your network that you allow, where you can store pictures, videos, music, or whatever you want. You don't have to keep multiple copies of your movies or music on all your computers, nor does your music need to be only on your PC, with your pictures only on your camera, and your movies only on your laptop, for example. What if your laptop was turned off? No videos? It's nice to have a central location all devices on your network can access, regardless of what they are. It is an easy way to organize your files or share files with guests. It's also a great way to create backups and protect your data, and depending on your setup, allow outside access of your home network. Run virtual machines, set up a media server with real-time encoding to any device, and much more. Let's go over the options to get this done and cover their pros and cons. Number 1, sharing a folder on your computer. This is the quickest way to get going. It's free, pretty easy to set up, and pretty much anyone can do it. If this is what you want to try, do the following. Open up Windows Explorer, expand Network, click on your computer in the list. On the right, it will show you what you are sharing. There's nothing showing up. You need to share something. Find the folder you want to share and right-click it, click Properties, click the Sharing tab, click Advanced Sharing, check the Share This Folder box, click OK, click Close, and then go back to the Network section and click your computer again. You'll see your shared folder now. Start moving files you want to share into this folder. You can browse to this location on your network with any device on your network now by typing /// and the computer name and view the files, watch the videos, and so on. Pretty simple. Just remember to only put in files you want to share. Under advanced sharing, you can specify who has access and what access they have if you want to get a little more granular. There are a few pros and cons to this option. First, the pros. It's free. Didn't cost us anything. Just a few clicks and you're sharing. No special equipment. We already had what we needed. And of course, it's nothing fancy. But if you don't need fancy, then fine. The cons? Well, it's just a folder on your hard drive on one of your PCs. There are no backups or inherent redundancies with this setup. If this hard drive goes belly up, then your files are toast, unless you have a separate backup solution. Also, if your devices only support MP4 files, then your files better be MP4 in the shared folder or it's a no-go. Also, if your computer that is housing this shared folder isn't very fast, then your file sharing might not meet your very nerdy needs. There's not a super easy way to gain remote access to these files. Maybe it's not a con for you guys. Also, it's nothing fancy, just a folder with files. There may be some devices that might not be able to access this file, but you know what? We're nerdier than this. We can do better. Number 2, sharing your media through Windows Media Player. I did this for a little while, and it worked for the most part. If all you want to do is, you know, a quick and easy way to share your media, such as music and movies, then you could do it through Windows Media Player. To do this, open Windows Media Player, click Stream, click Turn on Media Streaming, and then click Turn on Media Streaming on the next page. You will see and change what devices your media is being shared with. Then just access your media on another supported DLNA device, like another computer, a smartphone with the right app, or a video game console, for example. Pros to this one, well, it's easy. Just a few clicks to get going, but you do need to configure the client. Free, clicking your mouse buttons doesn't cost a thing. And lastly, you shouldn't have too much trouble finding a device that will work with this. The cons are, well, not all devices will be able to access this content from your computer when it's shared this way. Also, Windows Media Player has been around a long time, so not sure how much time it has left. It's not the smartest system. Only files that Windows Media Player knows about, that are in its library, are shared. And then lastly, a little bit of a limit to file types. Because of that, it will only share media. It can't share your spreadsheets, presentation files, or PDFs, for example. Number 3, USB drive attached to your router. If your router is fairly new, and not the cheapest one available, then it probably has a built-in file server that can act as your network storage. Plug in a USB thumb drive or external USB hard drive to the USB port on your router, configure a bit on your router, and you have network storage. Is it fair to call it network attached storage? It is plugged into the network. Anyway, I digress. Most of the time there is only a little bit of configuration needed, but if there is, log into your router and set it up how you want. Check the router's manual for details. This is, in my opinion, better than our first two options, but only in a few ways. It's pretty easy to set up, as long as you don't have issues logging into your router, or your router isn't prehistoric. If you already have a USB drive, then there is no cost. If you need to buy something, a cheap USB drive isn't super pricey these days. Depending on your router, it might be easier to set remote access to your files from the internet, but for security reasons, not usually recommended. And lastly for the pros, it's not on a computer on the network, it's really separate storage attached to the network. For cons, if your router is cheap or low on processing power, your streaming may not be ideal if several devices are streaming or accessing data, or your transfer speeds may not meet your very nerdy standards. Also, there is nothing protecting your files in this scenario. And then last, not all external drives work with all routers. My external drive was working perfectly on my older router, but gave me issues on my newer Linksys router. Why? I don't know. Okay, I hear you. That's not nerdy enough for you. If you want more features and better performance, you can purchase an official NAS or network attached storage. These devices are standalone units that you connect to your network. They have their own processors and their own little operating system with one or more bays that are usually easily accessible to change or add drives as you need more space. This one's from Synology. It's their new DS420J, link in the description. It has four bays, a 64-bit dual-core ARM processor, and 1 gigabit LAN. They're not sponsoring this video, I purchased this myself, but I thought it was a pretty good option for the budget-minded, so let's check it out. So at number 4, commercially available NAS. I had a few 500 gigabyte hard drives lying around that I used. The drive bays aren't hard to get to, but you do have to remove a few screws and the top to get to them, on this NAS at least. After installing the drives, I hooked the thing up on the network by connecting its Ethernet cord to a switch in my garage that goes to the network equipment in my office closet. I powered it on and pulled up its webpage to configure it, which was pretty easy. These things really take your network attached storage to the next level. This will do much more than just hold my files. There are several programs or services you can install on this thing, and other NASs like it, to increase security, add features like a media server, remote access, store videos from security cameras, file backups, and much more. As long as you have enough drives, it will default to its Synology hybrid RAID setup without needing you to do anything. This means right out of the gate, it is protecting my data. If one drive fails, I just have to replace it, and no data is lost. The webpage for the NAS is easy to follow, and it has lots of info and settings to fiddle with. Using Surveillance Station, it will allow you to detect and capture video from supported security cameras that are on your network, which is cool. Apparently, mine isn't supported. We also installed Plex on the NAS, which allows you to organize and stream your personal collection of movie, TVs, music, and photos anywhere on all of your devices. Plex does more than this, but I don't want this video to be too long. We installed the Plex client on our Xbox, and we are really enjoying the experience over just browsing files in an Internet Explorer window. The speeds we get out of this NAS is pretty nice. We'll peak out around 111 megabytes per second, which I'm okay with. It's been nice to have, and I'm glad I got it. I don't think it will encode video in real time, and it might not be able to host virtual machines, but for me, that's not an issue. If you're the type that isn't super techy, but do want some of these sorts of features, a commercial NAS is the way to go. Pros? Well, tons of features. Most will have lots of options, features and programs to allow for lots of cool things. Performance is much better than the previous options covered, depending on how much you want to spend. Also, dedicated hardware to serve up your files. You know, it's not taking up resources from your router or your office PC. 24/7 availability, always available as long as you set it up that way. Also, most NASs will offer or have backup solutions set up by default so your data is safe. Although, you may want at least a 2-bay NAS to get more backup options. And despite all this thing can do, it's not super hard to set up. Alright, a couple cons. Most NASs are fairly energy efficient, but it is another device in your house. Most NASs aren't cheap, and if you want features like multiple real-time encoding to certain devices, then you'll pay for it. The NAS I purchased was $300, so not bad, but not a small chunk of change either. Sometimes they're a little hard to upgrade, especially these budget NASs. They're not always that easy. I can't upgrade the RAM on this one, for example, but most all will allow for flexibility on the hard drives you use and how you can swap them. Alright, on to the last option, the do-it-yourself open source NAS setup. So, if a commercial NAS still isn't nerdy enough for you, then you could always grab some spare hardware and install something like TrueNAS Core or Unraid. TrueNAS Core used to be called FreeNAS. IX Systems, the company behind FreeNAS and TrueNAS, brought them together under the TrueNAS name and branded the free option as TrueNAS Core. Clear as mud, right? So grab a spare PC and install TrueNAS Core, or Unraid, or whatever flavor you prefer, and follow its documentation to get it going. This is basically going to be a computer hooked up to your network with a LAN cable in your switch or LAN port on your router, and configured to act as a NAS. For some of the pros, this sort of setup gives you the extra freedom to set up your TrueNAS or whatever NAS OS you use just how you want it, with more ability to expand down the road. Want to double your RAM or upgrade the CPU? No problem. Super customizable. If it's out there and available for TrueNAS Core or your NAS OS you choose, then you can set it up. ZFS, the ZFS file system, or the Z file system perhaps, that TrueNAS uses at least, is very robust, very scalable, and obsesses about data integrity and performance. Also, you can install and set up almost everything that our earlier commercial NAS from Synology will do, plus more likely. If you have spare hardware lying around, you could get one set up for nearly no cost, and TrueNAS Core is free. Also, it will run on older hardware. It's a pro, as long as you don't use hardware that's too old. TrueNAS Core shouldn't require super powerful hardware. And a couple cons while we're at it. While TrueNAS Core might not be considered hard to set up, it might scare away a few non-tech-savvy people who might just prefer to pay for a commercial NAS. And lastly, it's only as good as your hardware you install it on. If it's really old hardware, then performance might not be that great. There you have it. Several options for centralized home network storage. Weigh the pros and cons and decide which might be best for your scenario. Personally, I've done all of these, and I really do like the ease of the commercial NAS. It has taken my network up to the next level, with Plex, built-in backup, and just the coolness factor. Although, no one knows, it just chugs along in our garage, but hey, I feel cooler. Anyway, can you think of something I missed? Fire away in the comments. On a side note, we've surpassed 500,000 plus subscribers, so thanks for subscribing and watching.